on purpose because you knew I was going to be here?
I did.
Two people. That, awesome. Excellent. And you work here. Okay, great. Good. So I do not want to interrupt your time. I know that there are a lot of important things you have to do, like falling in love and being cool. So I am going to read an excerpt from my book, and then we're going to do a little interview, and I think we might do a Q&A? I'm not sure. So the book is about dealing with agoraphobia and panic attacks. Does anybody else feel like interactive is just one giant panic attack? I felt that way when I was at the convention center yesterday. I had this moment where I was just like, I feel like I'm gonna die, which apparently is just something that happens when you're here. This is my first time here, and I didn't realize that. But then that quickly turned into joy when I got to avail myself of all the fun opportunities that are happening here at South by Southwest. So the book starts with a chapter called In Simplest Terms and Most Convenient Definitions. Lee Redmond of Salt Lake City, Utah, had the world's longest fingernails. She stopped cutting them in 1979, and according to the Guinness World Records website, they measured a total of 28 feet 4.5 inches by 2008. At 2 feet 11 inches, her right thumbnail was the longest of all. When Redmond initially secured the world record, she announced plans to cut her nails. In the August 10, 2006 edition of the Deseret Morning News, Salt Lake City's more conservative paper, she described her daily activities, including grocery shopping, cooking, and taking care of her husband, an Alzheimer's patient. She said of her nails to reporter Tammy Walquist, "It's strange how they become you. It's almost your identity. It'll probably be a trauma after 27 years to cut them off." She then changed her mind, unwilling to part with them. She turned down tens of thousands of dollars to slice them down to socially acceptable length on live television. On Tuesday, February 10th, 2009, the sports utility vehicle in which Redmond rode was involved in a collision. According to the SLC police, Redmond was ejected from the vehicle and sustained serious but not life-threatening injuries. She survived, but her nails did not. Each one broke off near the finger. Is everybody cool if I say adult words? Does anyone have a problem with me saying adult words? Thank you very much. When I heard about Lee Redmond's accident, my first thought was not, Jesus, how the fuck do you insert a tampon with 2-foot-long fingernails? That was my second thought. My first thought was, why on earth would anyone choose to be a freak? To my mind, freaks generally come in two categories, those whose freakishness was visited upon them and those who devote considerable time and effort to creating and maintaining their freak status. I am one of the former, and I have never been able to understand the latter. When I was a child, I began to experience panic attacks that increased in frequency and intensity over several years. This condition eventually led me to develop a fear of leaving my small studio apartment, and finally of leaving my bed even to go to the bathroom. The ensuing complications were pungent. By the time I was 21, I was a full-on obsessive, cowering, trembling agoraphobe. How serious was it? Well, because I was too frightened to go to the hair salon, I let my roots grow out, which, gentle reader, is truly a sign of desperation in a born and bred daughter of New Jersey. The word agoraphobia comes from the Greek phobia, or fear, and agora, or marketplace. In simplest terms and most convenient definitions, my psychiatric diagnosis is that I'm afraid of the mall, which I can assure you is untrue. New Jersey claims to be a state, but it is actually a gigantic slab of cement upon which malls sprout like blisters and corns on the stubby, scrubby feet of overworked chain-smoking strippers. These malls are interconnected by a complex, ill-conceived system of congested roads. You are not allowed to take a left turn anywhere in the entire state. If you try, the rest of us will run you over on our way to the Macy's white sale. If you opened up my chest and examined my heart, I'm fairly certain you would find stamped therein a precise map explaining how to get from the Bridgewater Commons Mall to the low-rent Quaker Bridge Mall to the high-endiest of high-end malls, the Alpha and the Omega, the Mall at Short Hills, valet parking, Neiman Marcus, sit-down restaurants. I feel at home in these temples to materialism. They have many bathrooms, and if you get anxious, you can always find pain-numbing food or a soothing, well-chlorinated fountain. In fact, my own life is so entwined with mall lore and magic that everything must go closing sales at mall shops fill me with an unbearable sense of despair. There is nothing I despise more than a once great mall gone to ruin, the victim of a poor economy or a competing mall in the neighboring town. These are ghost malls, and they haunt my dreams. Their stores, empty husks of commerce, are tragic reminders of our own mortality. I can't handle the recent spate of recession-era store closings. I'm still not over Structure, and that old warhorse died over a decade ago. Does anybody else remember Structure? Yeah. Chess King, anyone? Yes, Wet Seal, thank you. I believe that there should exist an end-of-year memorial montage for all the mall stores we've lost. You know, like they have at the Academy Awards ceremony each year. And I believe this montage should be set to Sarah McLachlan's In the Arms of the Angels. A solemn voice, mine perhaps, should intone the names of the deceased as images of their gone but not forgotten merchandise flash across the screen. Circuit City, I'll whisper. Tower Records. Borders. Viewers will weep. It'll be fucking beautiful. To sum up, my diagnosis notwithstanding, I'm not really afraid of the marketplace. Quite the opposite, in fact. But I have been afraid of many other things. Here are some of them in a handy chart form that will get you up to speed. I'll stop reading there because the handy chart form is kind of hard to translate to reading out loud. But if you buy the book, you can see it. And the fears include everything from leaving my home to having a wet head to driving to being a passenger in a car. So I guess we can bring Rob back on now and we can talk about the book a little bit.
Thank you so much, Sarah.
Oh, of course. Did you know that you can read books via Google Play? You can, you guys. Isn't that crazy? You should do it today. Okay.
That's right. Agoraphabulous is available on Google Play.
It is.
So we're really excited you came out today, and I found your book hysterical and inspirational
and
really brave. Sarah has gone through a lot in her life and has come out an incredibly strong person, and the way she exposes herself is amazing. But if you could start from the beginning, kind of explain what agoraphobia is.
Sure. Does anybody here, I won't call on you, but does anybody else know what agoraphobia is? Have you ever heard of it before? Yes! What enthusiastic gentleman in the back, like, yes! So agoraphobia is basically a fear of fear of being in public spaces. So it's a fear of crowds and traveling. And I'm on a book tour right now to promote this book. So you can see how it's a little bit ironic that going on a book tour to promote a book about being afraid of traveling. And South by Southwest kind of, for people who are agoraphobic, South by Southwest pushes like all the agoraphobic buttons. But it's fine because I'm full of so much delicious Prozac in addition to the lemonade that you can get here. So that's fine. But yeah, so it's basically a fear of traveling and a fear of crowds, and a lot more people have it than folks generally know. You freak out, you have a panic attack in a crowd, you spontaneously feel like you're gonna die. It's fun, it's kind of goth, it's interesting.
When was your earliest memory of having these sensations and realizing you may be agoraphobic?
I think I was 10 when I realized that maybe I didn't handle like train trips and plane trips and bus trips and car trips the way that normal people did. So I think I was about 10 years old, yeah.
Can you walk us through what that experience was like?
Has anybody ever had a panic attack? It feels like the, this guy in the back is awesome. It feels like the inverse of an orgasm. That's the best way I can explain it to you. Like, take the most amazing sensation that you've ever had in your life and flip it. That's what it feels like. It feels like the moment right before you throw up, but before you get the relief of puking. I'm so glad I'm talking about this while you guys are eating. That's what a panic attack feels like, basically. And it's this sudden surge of fear that's very irrational. It comes out of nowhere. And you go into the fight or flight response, and so you're tensed as if you're ready to like fight an attacker, but there's no attacker. You're just hanging out at Whole Foods near the cheese aisle and trying to decide what kind of cheese to buy. Or you're in line at the bank, or you're sitting in a lovely tent at the Google Android house. I'm just hoping to try and like induce panic in everybody who's sitting here right now.
So one of the most stark, you know, stories in the book is how you kind of walk through when you were stuck in your room in college and some bowls that you kind of alluded to before that were in the room. Can you talk us through that story and kind of, the moment where you maybe hit rock bottom and how you got out of there?
Sure, yeah. I mean, there was a time in my life when I was genuinely afraid to leave my bedroom, much less leave the house. And so so the book talks about that. Like, I swear the book is funny. It's not all depressing. But the first part of the book particularly deals with mental illness and debilitating mental illness. So yeah, I got to a place where I wasn't even leaving my bedroom because I was so afraid. A lot of people who are agoraphobic kind of almost literally paint themselves into a corner. Like, first we will just decide, okay, I can't take trains anymore because I felt I had a panic attack on a train, so I just can't, trains are out, not taking trains anymore. And then it happens on a bus and then a plane, and then we think, okay, well, I just won't leave my home city. And then it happens in a neighborhood and we decide we can't go to that neighborhood anymore, I can't go to this neighborhood anymore, I can't, and it's so on and so forth until you've really just sort of painted a boundary line around yourself and you're just left with you. And that's generally the point at which people recognize that they need some help. Sometimes it happens before then, but that's how it was for me. It really took some friends intervening and pointing out that maybe it wasn't actually like normal or healthy to just stay in your house and not bathe ever. So that was when I was 21, and I'm 31 now. So it's been a while. It's been a long, hard road, but I'm doing pretty well.
Yeah. And how was your family instrumental in kind of helping your rehabilitation?
They were really instrumental. They were incredibly supportive. And I come from a family that's immensely crazy. So it was great because they were very prepped for one of their own to go nuts. Like, we all kind of pop off at that very special age between 18 and 24, like we lose our shit. And so it was not unexpected that you know, that someone in the next generation would do that. And they were very welcoming, so I got a lot of really good care.
That's great. One of the threads that kind of runs through the whole book is your connection with spirituality. Mm-hmm. Can you talk to us about what that's meant to you and your experiences with spirituality?
I guess I'm sort of in a weird place with it because I write in the book about being raised Catholic and then later on working at this really like woo-woo hippie retreat center for an insane pair of homosexual gentlemen. And you know, I've had a lot of adventures, and I think in that search for spirit, I've had a lot of very mundane real-world adventures that have been pretty ridiculous. But right now, I think that my religion is probably gratitude. That's probably the extent of it.
And you mentioned in the book your experience working at this blessed sanctuary.
Yeah.
Which is a hysterical part of the book,
Thank you.
Experience you kind of walk us through. Can you tell some of the stories from your that time in your life?
I basically worked at, I don't know if anybody here has ever like gone on retreat or visited an ashram or gone through a really heady excellent. Okay, so one of the things that you learn when you go to a spiritual retreat center is that all the real world problems are still there, and that somebody who would be an asshole in the office is still an asshole in the meditation hut or the sweat lodge. And so I write about that. I write about that a lot. And like, sometimes the most chill seeming yoga teachers are actually the people who would make the greatest fascist dictators in the world. When you work for them, you find that out. So I worked for some guys who, as a business, taught yoga and different things, and it was a very eye-opening experience. It was really fascinating, actually.
What did you learn about people through that experience?
I learned that the people who claim to be the most enlightened and spiritually advanced are often the biggest douchebags. That was my thing that I learned. Namaste.
So we talked about the agora part, but there's a lot of fabulous in the book. You are a comedian, so there's some really hysterical stories, and you know, you talk through your going into the comedy profession. Can you talk to us about your first stint in stand-up and what that was like?
Yeah. Doing stand-up is something that only crazy people should do, I think. I think that most of us who do comedy, and of course there are many delightful comedy offerings that I hope you guys are enjoying this week, but most of us who do comedy, I think, are in some way doing it out of some kind of twisted, unhealthy need. You know, for me, it's a need for affection. For other people, it's a need for power. It's a need for this, it's a need for that. So comedy in and of itself, I think, if you're a comedian, like, you're probably pretty fucked up. So it was, comedy is great because there's no one in the comedy world who's ever blinked an eye when I've told them stories from this book or when I've talked about some of this stuff on stage, because if they're not dealing with something similar, they know someone who is. So it's kind of this very strange, dysfunctional, ultimately kind of loving, weird community of crazy people. So I feel like I've found my peers.
I've seen your stage show and I've read the book, and your writing is fantastic.
Thank you.
What made you want to express these stories in a book and share it?
Well, I think growing up, when you grow up and you have an undiagnosed mental illness or an improperly diagnosed mental illness, I think a lot of times you think you're the only person who has it, and you're the only person who has your thing, and you don't have the language to speak about it, and you don't know how to describe it or explain who you are or what you're dealing with. So you feel really isolated. So my point was A, to make some sweet advance money, and B, to write something that people could read and actually feel really sort of comforted by. And comforted and amused at the same time. Because I tried really hard in the book, like, to mock myself, but not to mock the condition that I was dealing with, because I know there are a lot of people who were going to read the book who are dealing with it too.
So in the book, you talk about your move from Texas to New York City.
Yes.
And one might think that New York City would be a challenging place for somebody who is agoraphobic. What was that like for you to move into New York and your experiences dealing with the city?
Are there any New Yorkers in the crowd here today? Excellent work. It's full of fucking psychopaths, is it not? So if you're, all of us are probably terrible people. So it's actually a great place to be if you are a whack job like myself, because inevitably I can walk down the street and do anything and there will be somebody else doing something weirder. So New York, much like the comedy world, New York is comforting because it's so bizarre, it's so strange, and there are so many oddballs there that as a weirdo, you don't feel so isolated.
So how are you doing today in terms
of... Pretty good.
Of...
You know, I had some lemonade, I'm here at the Google Android house, I got some sweet boots on, which are amazing.
Which is all awesome, but yeah. In terms of your condition, your rehabilitation...
I'd say I'm overall doing really well. You know, I think for most people with any form of mental illness, whether it's depression, anxiety, even getting into some of the more intense stuff like bipolar, schizophrenia, things like that, it's not about a cure, really. It's about finding the treatment modality, the healing modalities that work for you, and learning to maintain, kind of. It's almost like maintaining sobriety. Like, it's something you have to work at. And you can have help in the form of medication and therapy and things like that. But it's not about ever being scot-free, like, I'm cured, I'm great. Like, I'm not. I'm still a barrel of problems, but they're managed reasonably well right now. And that's what I think the book is able to convey.
And what's next for you in terms of comedy and performing and writing?
I am working on a young adult novel. I'm working on a YA novel that we're trying to sell that is... it's an updated version of The Great Gatsby, but they're teenagers and Gatsby is a girl. So it's kind of like one of those Clueless / Cruel Intentions kind of, you know, reduxes, I guess. But so it's kind of, it's dark and it's funny and it's fun, and I hope we sell it so that I get a chance to write it, because it's pretty like fun concept, I think.
That sounds great. Excellent. Well, thank you so much, Sarah.
Thank you.
It's been great having you here.
Thank you.
Sarah's book, Agoraphabulous, is available now on Google Play. It's hysterical and brave and really inspiring, so you should pick it up. Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you. Thank you guys so much. Thank you.